Good morning, everybody. Welcome to our next online learning session with the topic Room Temperature Control and Additional RTC Functions. My name is Thorsten Reibel from the Competence Center Europe Smart Buildings. In the last sessions, we have shown already the standard functions regarding room temperature control, but there are some specialties left we would like to show today in theory. Followed then next week by also a practical learning sessions around these additional RTC functions. Duration of the session today, I think not much more than 30 minutes, or for sure less than 45 minutes as planned. So we will see, depends a bit also on your questions, of course. Good, what is the agenda for today? So numerous additional functions, RTC functions, I would like to show. I start with the additional stage heating and cooling. Switching between heating and cooling is also an important function we need. If you have both heating and cooling in an installation, then we can limit the temperature, whatever it means. Forced operation is a further function. And weighting of temperature inputs. So if I measure at different locations of the room temperature, I can calculate a mean value, for example. But I will explain how it works. And then we have a special function called summer compensation for cooling solutions. The valve can be purged. It's a special function as well. Can be manually overridden. And we have a so-called six-way valve option in Fencoil controllers. Then if we have a fan, there are some other specialties like the operating mode, the speed limitations here as well, start up and run on behavior. So I will explain everything together with ETS screenshots a bit in theory, but I think this will be then understandable. So what we are seeing in the next slides is mainly together with a fan coil controller, because there's also fan speed control possible, but everything except fan is also valid for our valve drive controller. And as we have also other components with this so-called unified RTC concept, you will find there the same functions also in some other KNX devices from ABB related to HVAC, to room temperature control. So let's start with the additional stage heating and cooling. So it allows us in a cooling or in a heating circuit to have an additional stage, an additional heating circuit or cooling circuit. So what does it mean? That means that the room can be heated or cooled more quickly, so faster, if there is a greater difference, for example, 2 Kelvin between the set point and the actual temperature. So we define a gap between set point and actual temperature to start a second circuit to heat or to cool. Of course, then we need an additional hardware, let's say an additional heater or cooler, and also additional valves and valve drives to do this. Let's have two examples. One for cooling. For example, you take for the basic stage, the standard stage, a cooling ceiling running continuously, not that fast, but normally sufficient. And if there is a faster cooling needed, then I have an additional stage cooling based on a fan coil unit, which is of course faster in reaction, thanks to the air draft coming out of the system, and can additionally cool, but much faster. And for floor, also for heating itself, for example, you have a floor heating system, the basic stage, so which is continuously running as well normally. But in a bathroom, if you enter the bathroom, you would like to have very fast, higher temperature, and then you start the towel rack with the additional stage heating, and then you have additional heater and a faster heating up. This could be the solution. Now here we see on the right how to set this, this additional and basic stage heating and cooling stage. So we start with the basic stage heating here, for example, area heating, or standard. And we would like to have an additional stage, which I can adjust here, for example, as a radiator. The same for cooling, area cooling, for example, cooling ceiling, the basic stage, and here the additional stage, in our case, the fan coil unit. You can select here both in the basic stage, but also in the additional stage heating and cooling different predefined cooling or heating solutions, area heating, electric heater, and so on. the same for cooling, and the so-called free configuration, then you have more flexibility in adjusting the control parameters, like the control value type. What do you want to have? Two-bit or two-step control, PI controller, continuous controller, PMW. All these things can be adjusted then freely. If you choose here the dedicated components, then it's fixed, and for this purpose, the right, let me say, parameterization. So in principle, you have four individual controlling solutions in one device here. That's possible. Yeah, how to assign these to the hardware of the component you have here. In our case, it's the fan coil controller. You see, activate basic stage heating via output A, for example, valve output A. We have two valve outputs here. The basic stage cooling could be then valve output B. But what happens with the additional stage heating or cooling if you have both? You have no additional or further hardware outputs here in this device. Means you have to send it via a group object to an additional valve controller or valve output, whatever you have, to control in total four different circuits. Yeah, then you have here the group objects to do this. Of course, you can do this also with the basic stage heating. This is also possible, or the basic stage cooling. You are completely flexible, but in principle, you need two additional outputs at least here if you have four circuits at all. Yeah, what else can be adjusted here? You see here in the temperature controller, the way to control the control type. You see here, I have adjusted here, not quite sure, but you see here fixed value PI control, pre-proportion is 4, the value 4K, and I proportion is 200. And if you have then here the free configuration adjusted, then it's flexible. You can change this here. Yeah, and then there are some further parameters to be adjusted. For example, the limitation of the control range that's not running between 100 and 0%. You can limit this here. This is also possible. And you have here further parameters like activation of temperature limitation. But this we will do in one of the next slides. Yeah, additional stage heating. Let's have a look here in some more details. When to start this, I mentioned already, we define a temperature difference between the set point and the actual temperature in the room. So in my case, if the temperature is, the room temperature is, or the set point is, has a difference of 2 Kelvin compared with the room temperature. In heating, for example, if you have a set point of 23 degrees, and if the room temperature is below 21, then it's a starting point for this additional stage heating, because then the gap is too high and I would like to have additional heater started. And then, of course, the gap between set point and room temperature will be solved very fast. That's our target here. This for heating, an example here. More than 2 Kelvin difference, that's the starting point. Of course, if you reach again less than 2 Kelvin, then it stops with the additional stage heating. That's clear. Let's have a look to the cooling solution. It's not really different. You can define here individual gap between set point and room temperature. Let's make an example. You have a set point of 23 degrees. So, but if the actual temperature is more than 25, then it's too warm in the room. I start the additional cooling stage to cool down again. And that's then again the situation we have seen with this heating. You can also adjust this difference between the set point and the room temperature to 0. It's possible. Of course, then there's no difference. Then always this additional stage heating or cooling is active. So you have two control solutions in the room running in parallel all the time. This is also possible, if it makes sense. So I will show my pointer. I think that's better now. So that's a further option here, if you would like to do this. Yeah, another important function is to switch between heating and cooling. Remember, we have the option both in a four-pipe system to run both heating and cooling, of course not at the same time, but you see here a four-pipe system with individual circuits. So during cooling, I have cold water in the first part of the solution, and during heating, I have hot water in the system. Yeah, the same is possible in principle in a two-pipe system. Then, of course, you have to decide when you have hot water and when you have cold water in your system. Yeah. So, and of course, it's important to know, are we in the heating or cooling mode for all the control functions? And there are two the options to change between heating and cooling, and I will show this. So let's here have a look to this description here. In a two-pipe system with both heating and cooling, the switching can be performed, can be used to inform the RTC and the FCCS that hot or cold water is a system. And then, of course, a change to cooling or heating. Okay. Yeah, in a four-pipe system, both with heating and cooling, of course, but never hot and cold water in parallel, and then, of course, I have to inform also the system what kind of water is now active, and it's only cold water at the moment, then of course cooling can be only activated. So maybe remember this diagram from one of the last session, the typical situation if you have both heating and cooling in your solution, and how does it work regarding yeah, the control output and also the, let me say, the room temperature. If you're in the heating mode, of course, then the room temperature is below the set point heating, in my case 21 degrees Celsius. And if there's a big gap, of course, I have maybe up to 100% control value, resulting in completely opening of the valve and maximum speed of the fan. In my case here is 3-step fan, so speed 3 is active. So if the gap is going getting smaller between set point and room temperature, the control value goes down, of course, and maybe speed 2 can be activated, and of course the valve will close more and more. And if I reach the set point, more or less it's off. And then we have typically a dead zone between heating and cooling, where neither heating or cooling is active. And then maybe 2 degrees or 2 Kelvin is the difference. We start with cooling the same way. If the gap is getting bigger, you have to increase the opening of the valve and also the fan speed. So this is the typical situation. Of course, you can also put set point heating to the same value of the cooling set point. It's possible, but then there's a danger that it's always changing between heating and cooling, yeah, if you are just around this set point with the room temperature. So typically, we have here such a so-called dead zone. Yeah, what can be done in the parameters to change between heating and cooling? You see here on the right the screenshots of the ECS. So we can do it automatically. Yeah, the change between the operating modes takes place depending on the temperature set in the parameter window, set point manager. So we have for heating and cooling activated set points. We know the room temperature. So if it's 27 degrees, set point for cooling is 25, of course, then we are in the cooling mode. Yeah, or if it's only 18 degrees in the room, set point for heating is 21, then we are of course in the heating mode. So then we have here a status object, and this gives us the information that we are in the heating or cooling mode automatically, so we don't have to do this. This is possible with a four-pipe system. Then we can do it via a group object. Intentionally, we would like to change between heating and cooling. For example, a solution which might exist that you say, okay, depending on outside temperature, I would like to change between heating and cooling. Or depending on the season over the year. So starting from June, I would like to start cooling, and starting from October, I would like to start heating. Yeah, so we are a timer. This can be done also automatically. Well, then we are not automatically, but via a telegram. Yeah, and then you can do the third option here, and which is called via group object or via slave. So again, we are any group object, but if you have an additional slave operating element in the room, then this can send a request to change between heating and cooling, and this can be also resulting in change of heating and cooling. And you see for a two-pipe system, it's only via a group object. these are the options here. But of course, very important to have the right operation in your heating or cooling solution, depending on on different situations, whatever you want. Yeah, a further option is to limit the temperature. It's not meant limit the room temperature. This we do with a normal room temperature control, because we measure the room temperature, we have a set point, and then of course it's limited. No, it's an additional measurement necessary to limit, for example, the surface temperature of a radiator. You say, okay, I don't want to have too high temperature. Maybe from the boiler there come hot water, can come hot water in the system, but I would like to limit this. So I have to measure at the radiator the temperature, for example, in order not to overshoot this temperature limit. Yeah? Or you would like to have not less than 10 degrees in the building, for example. You measure this additionally as well. Yeah? Or with a floor heating system, that's a very typical solution. You don't want to overshoot a certain surface temperature on the floor, which can damage the floor or the wood which is on the surface on the floor. So you need here real temperature limitation as well. So what does it mean? We have to measure additionally this temperature, whatever it is, and we can adjust here in the parameters a temperature limit. Yeah. With the hysteresis is also important. If you have kind of two-step control, it's in principle two-step control. If you overshoot this value, you stop heating or stop heating here in this case. So you adjust normally hysteresis. And if you have a PI controller, you can also freeze the I part of the controller. What does it mean? If you limit then the temperature, the control value will increase continuously, because there is no change, and then you get a very big control value, and then if you go back to the normal function, it will just open completely the valve, something like this. So you can freeze this here as well, or even reset. Yeah, and where to measure this additional temperature? Options are the following: that you use the internal inputs of our valve or fan coil controller, where we can measure temperature as well. Or the other option, of course, is to get it via a telegram from any other analog input, for example. Yeah? But remember, our fan coil controller and also valve drive controller are this inputs, both binary but also temperature analog inputs. And then, of course, you can use this as well. So a further option, you find it here under temperature controller and basic stage heating or cooling, the same, of course, and then under extended settings. And that's adjustable here. They can activate this. So the further function I would like to show is the so-called forced operation. I think during our other sessions we mentioned this already, but not in details how to parameterize this. So what is the result of a forced operation? It's a one-bit telegram, or one-bit group objects you find here. And then you can bring either the valve, only with valve drive controller, for example, but with a fan coil controller also the fan speed, and also the additional relay you might use in a defined state. So due to any situation in your room temperature control, maybe the boiler is damaged or the chiller, nothing is working properly, but you would like to have at least the valve open to 50% in this case, and the fan running in speed 2, for example. Yeah. Or if there is an electrical heater connected to the relay output, you would like to start or to close this contact to start this additional electrical heater. So you override in principle the control value, which is not working properly maybe due to any malfunction, the room temperature control, to a fixed value. Yeah, and you can do it with two options, so-called one-bit object here. In this case, let's have a look to the fan coil controller. You can define your control value, maybe 50%, and then the fan can be adjusted according to this control value, also in 50%, or three other defined values, a third, two-third, or 100%. Yeah? And the same with the relay. Of course, with the valve drive controller, you have only the option to adjust here the valve via the control value. Yeah, with one bit you have one forced operation function available, but if you use a two-bit forced operation object, which is a bit special object, 2-bit principle, 4 states you can represent here. We use 3. Our universal interface, for example, can send 2-bit signals, and typically any visualization, I think also touch panels can do this. But with a 2-bit, we have the option to adjust 2 different forced operations. Forced operation active on and active off. And then for both individual states, both for the valve, the fan, and also for the relay. That's the option here. Yeah. And of course, we can turn off the forced operation as well. It's also possible here. Yeah, thanks to the 2-bit group object. So let's come to weighting of temperature inputs. If you have a room temperature control, of course, you have to measure the room temperature. Yeah, this is clear. And in your room temperature control, whatever you have, or here connected maybe to our fan coil controller, we can connect typically one temperature sensor, measure the temperature, everything is working, standard function. But in some cases, you would like to, or you have to measure more than one point in the room. Think about huge office rooms where you have different temperature zones. Maybe there's also an entrance area where cold air is coming in all the time, or next to the window, not well isolated. You have lower temperature normally. So you would like to measure also in these parts of the room additionally. You can do this, of course. There are different options. You can install an additional room temperature controller slave, for example, for measurement mainly, or and for operation, or you install some other temperature sensors connected to the temperature input of the fan coil controller. But how to evaluate all these temperature measurements? And that's the task here, also weighting of the temperature inputs. So what can be done? We can, of course, take all these values and calculate any kind of mean values out of this. So how to get these values, of course, I mentioned already here, we have the inputs, A, B, C, or D. We have 4 binary slash analog temperature inputs here in our valve drive and fan coil controller. That's possible. Via any group object, think about any analog input, and this is also possible. Of course, also internal measurement. This is possible here if I connect it to the one of the 4 inputs here. That's meant with internal measurement, and external is via the group objects. What kind of options do we have here? So let's go to some examples. Here we have an example with 2 external measurements, and we would like to weight it 50-50. Let's say 50-50, or the 50% and 50%, so you have a typical mean value out of both measurements. Yeah? For calculation of the control value in the controller, for example. Yeah. There's another option, or you can do the same here with internal and external measurement, of course. Internal then connected to one of the temperature inputs, and external then via group object. What happens if you have 60-40? So one is calculated with 60%, the other with 40%. It's not a mean value anymore, but a weighting. This is formula here, 21 multiplied with 0.6 plus 24 multiplied with 0.4, and this results then in 22.2. Oh, this is here. Then the used room temperature for calculation of the control value. Further options, if we have here now 80-40, yeah, the same. But here we have more than 100% in the addition of both values. It's also possible. So before that, it was always in total 100%. Now it's 120% of principle, resulting in another kind of calculation. So you again multiply it with the value 0.8 and 0.4, but then divided by the sum of 0.8 and 0.4, resulting then in a slightly different value. So this you have to know if you adjust here the percentage values. Otherwise, you might have a wrong calculation. Yeah, I mentioned in principle 3 sensors can be used, internal one and 2 external via group object. So internal again connected to the input of the FCCS. But in principle, you can connect to all four temperature inputs of the device, individual temperature sensors, plus we have the two group objects, two external measurements, so in total six. Yeah, this is a bit strange, but maybe a more academical discussion here, but just to show you what is possible. So the four sensors will be used then as a mean value out of these four measurements. So the four sensors connected to the inputs and plus the two external measurements, of course. And thus you can weight then again here. Yeah. So internal measurements then mean value out of four, up to four, and then weighting up to your adjustment here in the parameters. Yeah. So in principle, very flexible solution. Let's say this here. Well, I think that's not typical. With three measurements, you are very good already, I think, in most of the cases. Yeah, then another option we have, so-called summer compensation. It's only for cooling because we talk about cooling in this case. What is the target of summer compensation? First of all, the target is to save energy and to have the temperature difference between the indoor temperature and the outside temperature, it might be very low, very high, the outside temperature, and to keep this gap not that big. Yeah, just for comfort reasons, but maybe also for health, reasons, that you don't have such a big difference if you are entering or you're leaving the building. Yeah. So, and this is a function in some regions all over the world mandatory. Yeah, in air conditioning systems. Yeah, just to save energy especially. Yeah, I remember when I was years ago in the Middle East region, and I was mentioning this function. This is not new, also existing in all the, also our former room temperature controller. Also in Middle East, where it's very hot typically, people were looking at me and also laughing on me, and they said, no, we don't use this here. Philosophy is there, as the colder the better, yeah, also in, out the inside in the building. Okay, but again, in some regions, this is necessary. So what do we do here? In principle, we increase the set point depending on the outside temperature. So the hotter it's outside, the higher the set point for cooling will be set. And the less cooling is then necessary in the building. So of course you have to measure then the outside temperature, typically done via a weather station, of course. And you see it here in this group object. And of course you can also activate and deactivate this summer compensation if you don't want to use it. That's also possible. Yeah, and then we have some parameters here. The starting point of this summer compensation, maybe with 21 degrees outside temperature, and the end temperature, where we stop the summer compensation more or less. And then you can adjust what will be the gap at the end, especially of the compensation. But you can start also here, not with zero, but maybe with already with 2 Kelvin, for example, this offset. Yeah, let's have a look to the diagram here. So a typical example. So you start with 21, but no, let me say jump here. You start then slowly, and you see with 32 degrees outside, we have 4 Kelvin difference to the set point in the room. So we increase here the set point then from 21 to 28 over this period. Yeah. And you see if I stop officially here with these summer compensation I've programmed, but it can still continue here with an even steeper, behavior just to save more energy. But of course, anytime maybe if it's getting too uncomfortable in the room, of course, it's up to you. You can stop anytime the summer compensation. That's always possible here. From the past, I remember also the winter compensation not existing here in our valve drive and fan coil controller. Just for your information, winter compensation is not for saving energy, vice versa, because you increase the set point during heating period just to consume more energy, to have it more comfortable in the room. It's in very cold reasons, regions necessary. I remember this from Russia, where you have very cold outside temperature, and then next to the glass, to the windows, it's getting too cold maybe in the room. And then they increase maybe the set point for the radiators in front of the glasses, the windows. That's a winter compensation. So vice versa, but also increasement of the set point, but for more heating in this case. But not really used normally all over the world, so we skipped this here, and these products not available in the parameters. Yeah, the other function also very common and known also from the past is so-called valve purge function. Just to operate the valves in a heating or cooling system, either with fan coil or with valve drive controller, just to operate the valve over the time where it's normally not operated. So if you have only heating, and during the summer, nobody will operate heating, then the valve will stay closed all the time. And this can result in getting stuck of the valve. So due to the not running water, the mechanic is not really working anymore of the valve drive. And then you have a problem when the winter starts and the heating period starts again. So, and how do we solve this problem? Very simple. Also during this period, we just open the valve continuously. But as there's no hot water in the system and the pump is not working in the heating system, for example, so there's no real heating, just only operation of the valve. And how can you do this? You activate this either via a group object, maybe an external timer. Then you say, okay, every week I start opening and closing the valve four times maybe. Or you say I do it automatically, so then every week will be done, and then you have also automatically operation of the valve here. This is the so-called valve purge here. So what else do we have? Manual override of the valve, a further simple parameter, yes, no only. You adjust it here at the valve output. And then you have a group object available, a so-called one byte object, because you would like to position the valve to any certain value. Yeah. You have also an enable disable object here. I think it's important. If you don't want to have this, you should disable this for sure, that nobody can override this at the moment. But overriding might be necessary for any commissioning tests or maintenance tests. Yeah. Wherever you need a dedicated position of the valve, independent of the normal function in the room, and then you can use this. That's the only function here, and nothing else but an additional two group objects with a value to be sent from outside, and the disabling and enabling. So special function, I think mainly in the commissioning phase, and then maybe in any maintenance phase. So then we come to another special solution, but this is only valid for the fan coil controller. For the fan coil controller with 0 to 10 volt valve outputs. And for the solution where you have both heating and cooling. And during my Climate Echo trainings, I did a lot in the past, when I mentioned the six-way valve, most of the people said, oh, never seen, never heard of it. But there is a market for this. Let me explain what's behind. This six-way valve, you can control both the heating and cooling circuit in a four-pipe system. So the other prerequisite is having a four-pipe system. Yeah? So heating, cooling, 0 to 10 volt, and four-pipe system. These are the conditions for this special valve, and you see it here. Six-way valve, because we have six connections for the pipes. But we have only one mechanic, one motor, and one 0 to 10 volt input to control both heating and cooling in a four-pipe system. So we save, or we need only one output, one valve output, 0 to 10 volt. And we have only one valve drive here and one motor, so we save a bit hardware. But it's a special valve, as you can see here. So what do we do? We adjust this here in our parameters, use six-way valve for the fan coil controller, yes. And then we decide where to activate heating and cooling, because it's only one output in principle, one 0 to 10 volt output, and in my case here, of course, we use valve output A. Yeah? So one 0 to 10 volt controls everything in this solution. Yeah? let's have a look to some parameters here. It's, as mentioned, 0 to 10 volt only, because these six-way valves work only with 0 to 10 volt control signal. That's a fact. And we will see in this diagram why. But first of all, to the parameters, you can also here, limit this 0 to 10 volt signal depending on your component, your valve component. So you see between 0 to 10 volt, I have any other values here available. 2 to 5, for example, it's also possible. Yeah, and how does this valve in principle works depending on the control signal 0 to 10 volt. In my example, I take 0 to 10 volt. So it starts with 0 and then you have 100% cooling. So value 0 means cooling 100%. Then of course, if I need less cooling, I increase this control value 1 to 3 volt and then I reduce the cooling. Operation means I close more and more the valve. That's the position of the valve on the y-axis here. Until I reach the complete closing, maybe with 3 volt or 4 volt, and then there is a kind of dead zone as well, maybe between 4 and 6 volt, where you have nothing open, neither the cooling nor the heating valve. And then anytime, maybe starting from 6 to 10 volt, you start to open the heating part of this six-way valve. Yeah, so it's a complex mechanic inside in the six-way valve to have only one circuit open, either the heating or the cooling circuit, depending on the control signal here, nothing else. So benefit also here is you can never have both heating and cooling circuits open. Yeah, so it's mechanically not possible here in this case. Again, a special situation, but just for your information, this is here also possible, just a parameter to be adjusted. Yeah, and if you have the 0 to 10 volt fan coil controller, remember you have always two valve outputs, valve output A and B. We use only valve output A, and this valve output B is not lost. You can still activate this here and use it. But in this case, you can use it, for example, for a variable air volume damper. So it's in principle a classical then analog 0 to 10 volt output you can use for any purpose, but typically in a HVAC system, the usage for a VAV damper could be possible, again with individual adjustments of the 0 to 10 volt signal here. Okay, so that's the six-way valve. And what else do we have as specialties, let's say? Maybe this remember also from the past with our fan coil actuator at that time, but now also with the fan coil controller. Fan operating mode, we have two options to adjust the way of control in a three-step fan. This is prerequisite here, not the 0 to 10 volt, but three-step fan, where we have three relays. Remember, we have the so-called changeover switch and step switch, which is different in the way of controlling or opening and closing the relays here. So with a changeover switch, we have only for each speed one relay closed, so the first relay of course. If we have speed 2, we open first of all the first relay from speed 1 and then we close the relay for speed 2, the same for speed 3. Changeover switch. And the step switch is vice versa. We additionally close the next relay if we go to the next fan speed. So with fan speed 3, we have all three relays closed. So you have to know which kind of fan control your fan coil unit has. That's important. So it's depending on the hardware. And then you decide what to adjust here. Very important, default adjustment is always changeover switch because it's the least dangerous version here. Nothing can be damaged, even if you have a step switch fan behind. With this one, it will not work properly, but not damaged. But if you have a changeover switch needed and you adjust step switch, what does it mean? You create short circuits in your motor, in the coils of the motor behind. Of course, short circuit is not good. can destroy the coil and the motor behind. Yeah? So important to know what to adjust, especially if you adjust your step switch. Yeah, and if you have fan speed switch over function here, then we can adjust here a so-called delay time between switching between these two speeds. So if I go from speed 1 to speed 2, first of all, I turn off relay number one for, in this case, 500 milliseconds before I turn on the second relay here. Also important for the right function of the FENCOIL unit, the motor behind, you should look at the technical data of the FENCOIL unit, which delay time here is required, but adjustable. So fan speed limitation we have in addition here. What does it mean? Very important if you have FENCOIL units and you would like to have here not always running maximum speed, you can say, okay, I limit the fan speed. And with a 0 to 10 volt device, we have three limits here available where you adjust. I would like to have it only running maximum to 60% or 100% or whatever, or between 30 and 70%. And you activate these limitations here via 1-bit group objects. So typical situation, if you would like to have less airdraft, less noise in a hotel room, for example, during the night, then you activate this limitation. So room temperature control is still running, but the fan is not exceeding a certain level you have parameterized here. Of course, resulting maybe in a cooling solution with higher room temperature, because the control is only via the valve, but not to the real needed fan speed anymore. But I use this always in hotel rooms, also in regions that's very hot. I accepted higher temperature, but less noise in the room. Yeah, when I was still traveling, I did it. Okay, so or here another case, if you have an unoccupied room, you would like to have a minimum speed, so never off. So nobody's in the room and presence detector says turn off FENCOIL unit, you have minimum 10% speed of the fan for ventilation. Yeah. So this is possible. Yeah. And we have three available with priorities here. So limitation one has the highest priority and limitation three is the lowest. So it's very comfortable. So also with manual operation, you cannot exceed these limits. This is also here fact. Yeah, this was here with analog output, means with 0 to 10 volt. What happens if we have a three-step fan coil controller behind? Then you see here the parameters. It's a bit different. Again, three limitations are available, but we have here, yeah, let's say out of the options between off and speed three, all options here to adjust. So we can say we would like to have only speed two and three, never speed one and never off. All these things are possible here then as well. So, and then fan start up behavior. We have two topics left, fan start up behavior. What does it mean? Fan level at which the turned off fan coil unit starts. So you are not in the room, you enter the room, presence detector detects you and fan coil starts, and then you would like to have a certain fan speed level at the beginning at least. So you start maybe with 100% fan speed for 5 minutes just to ventilate the room. Yeah? And this time is also adjustable here. How long at which level? That's adjustable here. With the analog output means 0 to 10 volt, a certain value, or with a three-step fan coil controller, a certain level. Yeah, typically again for hotel rooms you enter it, for example, just would like to ventilate the room, and then it's the most comfortable situation in the room. Yeah, here you see the principle. So we start with a certain level for a certain time, then we have a delay when before switching over to the next level, and then we come to the needed level depending on the control value, which might be speed one or whatever. And this can be also adjusted with a minimum time here. And yeah, this is the diagram. And then later, maybe it's still too less the speed, and it increases the speed again to the next level maybe. Yeah, and then you have also so-called run-on behavior for fans. What does it mean? Time the fan stays in the current level, though a lower level is required. So I would like to go, the control value says, please go down to the lower level, but the time it should stay in the former level is not yet over, and then it stays in this former level. So you force in principle the fan to stay a certain time in certain levels. That's a target here. Yeah? So for example, if you would like to turn off your FENCOIL unit, it does not turn off immediately. Maybe it was in speed 3. Then it stays another 20 seconds in speed 3 first of all, another 20 seconds in speed 2, and another time of 20 seconds in speed 1 before it turns off. Yeah, so just maybe to remove the humidity in the air conditioning system, certainly, and to have no left humidity in the air pipes, for example. So for a three-step fan, we can adjust for each speed level a certain time, individually here. For the 0 to 10 volts, it's a bit different. We can only say at which level this is fixed, 20%, how long it shall run. So it's only the time for 20% is adjustable, not more, not less. So not here like this, three steps to go down maybe. So it's just for turning off, going down to stay in certain levels a certain time. Okay, that's all the additional or special functions I would like to explain today. We have two final slides here. Jürgen has shown in the former sessions always these priorities of the additional functions we have already shown a bit. And here an overview of all these priorities of all, operations we have here, starting from bus voltage failure. Of course, is the highest priority, then nothing can be done except the bus voltage failure. It happens, and then a certain function should take place, for example. But you see here, all the other functions have then lower priority. So in the middle of the IBUS tool, it has a higher priority, for example, than the direct operation via keypad, if you have IBUS tool active and test here some functions. Yeah, this is for the valve, for the fan under controller mode, and the same here for the actuator mode. If you have pure actuator functions, of course, we do not have all the controller features here. For example, here, controller mode via group objects, of course, this is not existing here, but similar features here. Just for your information, it's very important to know this order of the functions and this its priority. So on the top is a higher priority, going down to the lower priority. Okay, very powerful functions, need some time to explain, and I hope this was quite interesting to know also the additional features. Again, we will come to the practice of these additional features as well. So you know where to find everything of the products and our training stuff, so I skip this here. So we did today the theory part of the additional RTC functions, and we continue then next week with the practice out of this. So as already seen in the former sessions, with real programming, ETS programming, and also IBUS tool demonstration. Yeah, and still something left, this HVAC, we will see what we are going to do then. Ventilation is a topic, air quality, so a bit more additional features, but talking more about, the air control features. Okay, then I say thank you for your participation. Thank you, bye-bye, ciao.